Let me explain myself. We are a church of all kinds of different church backgrounds in here. We were not denominationally started by any one denomination. We are kind of Bapticostal, if you want to know my church slant. I grew up independent Baptist. I married an Assembly of God girl, and I fall somewhere right in between those two things. And so we have Pentecostals in here that are like, finally, you know, whenever I get on one subject, and others are like, don't start that stuff here, I'm out of here, that kind of thinking. And I've got to wade through all of that. So I'm going to ask everyone to listen to the Word of God as it comes forth and let Him teach us what He would have us do and be as a church. Thank you. Prophet's reward for you. Amen. So for today, the Pentecostal background folks will be happy because I'm going to elaborate reasons for considering some of those things. And then then next week or the week after, I'm probably going to make some of those kind of mad, and I'm going to make some of those Baptists go, yeah, finally, somebody telling the truth around here. And we're going to work through all that or some mixture of all of it as the Lord leads. So just please lay what you have learned or heard anywhere else aside just for a moment. Receive what the Word of the Lord is today. And if you care, go and study those things and see if these things are so for yourselves. And if you don't care, like I said, don't not listen and then come back and care later. All right? Don't say, wasn't the way I was brought up. My preacher told me. Okay, until you can find it in the Word, please listen and learn as we go. Is that a good advice? Amen. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, starting verse 1, says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. I love the way that's written. Don't be an ignoramus. In other words, listen and be educated on things about spiritual gifts. You know that you were Gentiles carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is accursed, no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are differences of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, and to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. Excuse me. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. And then verse 13 says, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, all have been made to drink into one Spirit. Now, again, there's enough in that one passage. I want to go ahead and take that and elaborate more, and that being verse 13, especially where it says, we were all baptized into one body. Now, there's going to be some key words you're going to have to look for. By, with, baptized, filled, received, and so forth. And some of those key words become very important, especially because in some places they're very interchangeable at times. So we start in here in verse 13. It says, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. First thing I want to point out that is we're talking about salvation here. We're talking about a time of salvation. By one Spirit we are all baptized into one body. So the Holy Spirit of God baptizes you into what? Into the body of Christ. Now, when I stand up here in this tank back here and I take people and I dunk them under the water and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, am I the Holy Spirit? No. I am baptizing them in water and then they raise up to walk in newness of life because that symbolizes what the Lord, the Holy Spirit of God, is doing in the hearts of people. This is just water. It is not holy water. It's just water. But that water becomes holy, if you will, because of what's happening in that water. You see, I can climb in that tank and I can swim around and I can scrub it out and I can repair it, fix it. I can do all kinds of things. I can splash around with a little rubber ducky, but it does not make me a Christian, right? However, my faith in Jesus Christ, asking the Lord Jesus Christ to come into my heart and save me, then an outward show to the audience of an inward change of heart can show that I am dying to my old ways, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life, and that baptism becomes something that is significant, and some would even argue part of your salvation. Now, I don't want to get off on baptismal regeneration. It's not what this subject is about. I believe that you're saved, and the thief on the cross was never baptized. I believe he still got to heaven. However, baptism and regeneration are so closely connected that you will almost never see them mentioned one without the other. Even the Ethiopian eunuch who was called on by Philip to say, hey, can you explain the scriptures to me? The Ethiopian eunuch, after believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, said, hey, here's water. Can we stop here and get baptized? And Philip's like, sure. And he baptized him right there. And baptism is closely related to salvation because it is the first act of obedience. It's the first step of showing the world what has already happened in your heart. And I believe that that this is a time symbolized by baptism whenever a person goes under the water and is raised up again. Not only does it picture the death, burial, and resurrection of life, not only does it picture the dying to your old ways and walking in newness of life, I believe that the Holy Spirit does something supernatural in your heart at salvation, which actually baptizes or plunges you into Christ. Now, I'm not saying you have to wait for that to happen until you get into a tank. This actually happens at the time you first believe. But the Spirit of God baptizes us into one body. Now, the reason why this is important is I'm going to illustrate in Romans chapter 8 and verse 9. I'm going to come up here on the board as well. Romans chapter 8 and verse 9 says, "But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his." That's pretty important, don't you think? So how do you know if you're his? How do you know if you belong to Christ? Because you have the Holy Spirit living in you. And he says, if you do not have the Spirit of God dwelling in you, then you are not his. So that's the first place we need to start with, is understanding that you are baptized into Christ by the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit regenerates your heart, that the Holy Spirit is sealed in your heart unto the day of redemption, that you will never stop having the Holy Spirit in your heart or in your life as long as you are a believer in Christ. And that that will never change. That is part of the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. And also in John chapter 3 and verse 5, I'm going to go there next. John chapter 3, verse 5, familiar scripture because Jesus is talking to Nicodemus about being born again. And in that passage, Jesus answers, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." Now, there are those who will say that means you have to be baptized and saved, and that's what the water means there. I don't know if that's true or not. I don't think so. However, one thing's for sure, you've got to be born of the Spirit. Whatever you define water as, whether that be natural birth and also spiritual birth, or whether you consider that some kind of connection with the baptism that the Holy Spirit does to baptize us into Christ, one way or another, we have to be born spiritually, and that's what happens when we get saved. We ask the Lord to come into our heart, He saves us, the Holy Spirit regenerates us, He makes us a new person, and that work of the Holy Spirit is a continuing and important work in our lives, and without the Holy Spirit of God, we cannot be saved. Does that make sense? All right, good. Now, Matthew chapter 3 and verse 11 goes on to the next thing. That's talking about salvation, first of all. Now, in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 11, I've got John the Baptist is speaking to his crowd, and he says, "I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance." And that's what the last prophet of the Old Testament did. We think that's Malachi, that's the last book of the Old Testament, but there was a 400-year drought of having any prophets in Israel until just before the coming of Messiah to Israel. And the last Old Testament prophet was John the Baptist. And of course, he's also that pivotal point of ushering in the new covenant. And that's where God spoke again to Israel through his prophet. And the prophet John the Baptist said this. He says, "I indeed baptize you with water." So we had baptisms. And the purpose of that baptism was a baptism of repentance. Going under the water, coming up, signifying that I am repenting of my sin and I'm readying my heart for Messiah, for the Savior that is to come. And certainly he did come during John's time. He says, I need baptize you with water of repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I. Who would that be? Jesus, right answer. He says, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Now, when Jesus baptizes you with the Holy Spirit, you got it all. Okay, let me start with that. You got it all. What exactly does that mean? Does that mean my salvation? Is that some kind of separate subsequent act? I don't know. I just don't know that if Jesus gets it, you got it. All right. However, the word does begin to show some things that we want to look at as we go. But starting with the fact that John the Baptist predicted a time where Jesus would come and not only, like you, allow the Holy Spirit to come in you and regenerate you, but also would baptize us with the Holy Spirit, illustrated with the picture of fire. Well, what is the fire thing all about? Baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. If you remember back in the Old Testament, there was a time where Moses, running away from Egypt, God calls him to himself, and he stumbles across in the wilderness a burning bush. And the significance of this burning bush was that it was on fire, but it was not being consumed. The bush burned and burned and burned, and first of all, it had to grab your attention because, hey, there's something on fire. It always grabs your attention, right? And then the problem was that the thing never consumed. It never spread to the rest of the brush around. It never was consumed. It just burned and burned and burned. And the fire never consumed that bush. And by the same token, the Holy Spirit burning His fire in your life will continue to provide light and heat and warmth and power, but He will never burn you out. If you're getting burned out, it's because you're not walking in the Spirit. And so the Lord wants to do this marvelous work. And so the burning bush symbolized the very presence of God. That was the significance of that the Spirit of God was being manifest in a form that we could see. And He took the form of this burning bush, that vessel of the ground being consumed with that which is very unnatural for a bush, which is fire or spirit. And so this illustrated the presence of God in Moses' sight. And so much so that He said, take off your shoes, Moses, because where you're standing is holy ground. Is in the presence of that fire, the very presence of God. And then we find that in the tabernacle days and before, whenever God led the children of Israel out of Egypt and rescued them at the Red Sea, that He stood Himself up physically as a cloud of smoke by day and a pillar of fire by night to give them light. And that fire represented again, just like with Moses, the very presence of God, the very fire of God, His manifest presence with His people. Now, you could pray and you could believe that God was in the heavens and He would hear you and all that. But He chose to take a time where He said, I will dwell with my people. I so want to dwell with my people that like I burned at the bush for Moses to be able to be in a one-on-one, face-to-face encounter, so I will be with my people Israel, and my very manifest presence will be represented by a pillar of fire, and it will lead those people through the promised land, providing them light and shelter, and even stood between them and the army of Egypt to protect them as well. And then we come to the day of Pentecost, whenever they were all gathered together in one place, as the Lord told them to do, and they began where they were praying and waiting on the Lord. And when the day of Pentecost had fully come, the Holy Spirit showed up and began the birthing of the church as we know it today in power and might. And in that meeting, something very strange and unusual happened that has never happened again anywhere in recorded history of the Bible or anything else. And that is that tongues like fire, or tongues of fire, if you will, lapping flames of fire, stood up above the heads of each of the believers there. The significance of that, of course, being that the very manifest presence of God was not only with the nation of Israel, but now actually each one of us is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and His manifest presence is now over each one of those believers individually, showing that it is truly God with us. Begun with the Messiah coming to earth and walking among men. And now he said, I'm going back to heaven and I'm going to send my Spirit. I will not leave you comfortless. And the fire of the Holy Spirit dwelt on top of each person, signifying that they, each one, were now the temple or the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit of God, just like God dwelt in the temple above the cherubim, above the Ark of the Covenant, as well as having that fire of signal above. And so that fire, John says, he who is coming after me is I'm not worthy of. He's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Something very powerful about that baptism with fire. And then in Acts chapter 1 and verse 5, we see the manifestation of that. Acts chapter 1 and verse 5, it says, For John truly baptized with water, Jesus says. First of all, it's not on the overhead, but he says that being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. Now, this is after the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. He's meeting with his disciples, and he says, Now, don't go anywhere. Don't leave Jerusalem yet. Don't scatter. Don't go back to the Sea of Galilee area. He says, I want you to stay right here in Jerusalem. Continue praying together until the Holy Spirit's power comes upon you. And he says, For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with what? The Holy Spirit, not many days from now. It does say Holy Spirit, right? Yeah, and it is Holy Spirit fire here. John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Now, earlier on, we talked about how we are all baptized into Christ. That baptism is a baptism of water, and it is a baptism of where and when the Holy Spirit does a marvelous work of regeneration in our life. But that is not the same as this baptism. And you say, well, how many baptisms are there? We can just find all kinds of them in the Bible, which is one of the reasons why this subject is so misunderstood so many times, because there are just baptism of fire, baptism of testing. There's all kinds of words that people, types that people can use that for, and it can be confusing. Back in 1 Corinthians 12, we talked about being baptized with water and the Spirit doing His work in us. We're all in part of that baptism. We're all who are saved are in that. But Jesus talks about a day where not only can you have the Holy Spirit living in you, but you can also be baptized or completely dunked in that. It might help to talk about what baptism, the literal word, means. The word baptize means to dunk, which is why we don't sprinkle. But, you know, just that's kind of like a separate thing unto itself. The word baptize means to dunk in. It's the word that they used to describe ships when they sank. It was plunged in. It's also the word you'd use when you put your hands into a bowl. You would plunge or baptize your hands into the bowl for washing. A ship would plunge or baptize itself when it sank. And so that's and what is the result of that? When that ship sinks, where does the water go? Inside the ship. So the idea of being baptized in the Holy Spirit is to be plunged into His presence so much so that He begins to pour Himself into you, the inside of you. And the result being, you don't have to get baptized again and again and again, but you do, having contained the Holy Spirit, He can fill you again and again and again. And so the receiving of the Holy Spirit, which we'll get to in a moment, happens at salvation, but this baptism is something that is when it gets to fill you. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. So Acts chapter 1, verse 5, Jesus said, John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Now, there's something very interesting. In this particular passage, now the next thing we're going to go to is John chapter 20 and verse 22. And what is significant here in particular is that we just read about a time where Jesus met with His disciples after His resurrection and before He ascended back to heaven. So it's that 40-day time period between those two. So Jesus has completed His work of salvation on earth. He's giving His last-minute instructions to His disciples, and He's about to leave and say, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. So there's that transitional time of 40 days in the middle where He's teaching them a few more things. One is, He says, stay where you are. You're about to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Now, in that same time frame, possibly the same night, I believe, John chapter 20 and verse 22 tells more about what happened in those discussions with Jesus. He appeared to them in John chapter 20 and verse 22. I'm going to start in 19. 22 will come up on the screen. But it says, "Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, that Jesus came and stood with them in the midst and said to them, 'Peace be unto you.' And when he had said this, he showed him his hands and his side, and the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And so he said to them, 'Peace be to you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you.'" And then verse 22 says, "And when he had said this, he did something very unusual. He walked up and breathed on them." It says he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Receive the Holy Spirit. And then, as we find in the other passage we just read, at some point during that night or some similar time, during that 40-day period, he also said, "And stay where you're at. And don't leave, because later there's going to be a baptism with the Holy Spirit." I don't know if you caught that, but there's two different things happening there. First, he breathes on them and says, "You disciples that are gathered here with me, this is your moment of actual salvation. Up to this point, I've been with you. God with us, Emmanuel. But starting from this very moment, I'm going to breathe on you just like God breathed on Adam in the beginning, and Adam became a living soul. So I'm going to breathe the very breath of God, the Spirit, the pneuma of God. I'm going to breathe on you, disciples, and you will now be regenerated. You will now have the Holy Spirit living inside you. You will now become born again, truly." And he breathed on them and said, "Receive," everybody say receive, "receive the Holy Spirit." You know what that means? That means they didn't have the Holy Spirit before. That's what that means. And so he breathed on them and said, "My very breath is going into you, and just like Adam was raised, so now you are breathing, and now you are becoming born again. You are now a living soul where you were not before. Now your spirit has been made alive where it was not before." That's an amazing passage of Scripture, and a very significant one, because in the same time frame he's saying, "Wait for Pentecost," he's saying, "Right now, get saved. Right now, receive the Holy Spirit. Let it regenerate you from the inside out. Let it make you born again. Let it begin the process of working in you and making you a new creation in Christ. And by the way, there's even more later. So wait for it. Wait for it. Wait for it." Because the baptism with the Holy Spirit is coming. And so from there, we go to Acts chapter 19. Verses 1 through 6, and we see an example in this. After the day of Pentecost had fully come for the Jews in Acts chapter 2, and after the first manifestation of the Holy Spirit came on the Gentiles in Acts chapter 10, we find yet another case, one of six in the New Testament that I find, where there is what we call an initial baptism of the Holy Spirit that we get to look at and observe and see what happened at it. And one of those happens in Acts chapter 19 with disciples of John the Baptist. And in this case, both things happen, although they're in short order. Both what things? They become born again and receive the Holy Spirit and begin to manifest the power of the Holy Spirit as on the day of Pentecost, both in very short order, but it did take it in an order. I want you to look at that. And so in Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 6, it says, "And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said to them, 'Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?'" Now, I'm not sure why he asked this, but it might have been for good reason. You ever know any disciples and they're just not acting too much like disciples? You know, like there's something wrong here. There's something a little missing here. And so Paul, in his discernment, says to him, "Hey, boys, you know, you claim to be disciples with us of the Messiah, but there's something missing. I need to ask you a question." He says, "Did you receive?" Everybody say the word receive. "Receive." Remember what Jesus said to the disciples? "Receive the Holy Spirit while you tarry for the baptism." Paul says to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" Well, naturally they would have if you follow the doctrine, right? And so they said to him, "We have not so much as even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And so Paul says, "Really? Okay, then into what then were you baptized? And so they said to him, into John's baptism. So again, the question is very significant. And Paul uses a specific word. He says, into what then were you baptized? Now I want to take you back just for a moment, back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13, our jumping off point there. It says, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. The Holy Spirit baptizes us into the body of Christ. And so then if you go back to verse 3 that we just read, he says, we have not so much as heard there is a Holy Spirit. He said to them, into what then were you baptized? Because it wasn't the body of Christ. And so they said, into John's baptism. He says, oh, okay, that explains it. Now I get where you're coming from. So you guys are like old school. You've been in the bushes a while. You haven't heard the latest from Jerusalem. Let me bring you up to date. Then in verse 4, Paul said, John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him. Well, who's that? Christ Jesus. That is on Christ Jesus. Then verse 5, it says, when they heard this, they began to argue and created their own church. No, it doesn't say that, does it? When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So at the point that they're baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, at that point, they receive the Holy Spirit into their lives. Because when we pray, Lord Jesus, come into my heart, can you imagine him, Jesus, the physical man, getting into my heart? He can't get in there. He's a physical Jesus, cannot get into my mind and my heart. So, but the Bible also teaches that God is a spirit, and the spirit of Christ Jesus is what comes into the spirit of my mind. And I pray, Spirit of Christ, when I say Jesus come into my heart, I mean the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ, come into my heart and regenerate me. And that's what happened here in Acts chapter 19, is they prayed and they asked him to come into their heart, and then they were baptized in his name, and in that time they received the Holy Spirit. And so they received the Holy Spirit when they believed. But Acts chapter 19 doesn't stop there. Because by this time, Acts chapter 2 had already happened. The day of Pentecost had already happened. By this time, Acts chapter 10 with the Gentiles had also received the Holy Spirit, and to their amazement were speaking in tongues and prophesying and doing all kinds of things that the disciples thought only the Jews were supposed to do, because it was their Jewish Messiah. Well, by now it was evident that the Spirit was out of the bag. And he was doing what he wanted to do within the hearts of men. And the church was growing, both Jew and Gentile. Jesus, being the Savior of all, had also filled them. And the church was growing in all kinds of places. And at that point in Acts chapter 19, he not only leads them to Jesus, but they are also ready to receive the rest of the story. Now, it kind of all happens together and runs together with them, but two different things are happening here. One is they have received the Holy Spirit in their salvation and baptism. And then in verse 6, it goes on to say, and when Paul had laid hands on them, this is after their baptism, it says, when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. But where was the Holy Spirit before? In them. Before they had received the Holy Spirit, he was sealed in their hearts under the day of redemption, and as evidenced by their immediate baptism in water. And now the baptism with water is over. Now it's time to be baptized in the Holy Spirit like they did at the day of Pentecost or at Cornelius' house. And now they were also free to be able to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And the wording here is exactly that the Holy Spirit came upon them, even though Romans 8:9 clearly makes it clear that if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're not his. So the Holy Spirit must have already been in them, having received the Holy Spirit. Now he comes upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied, which is two of the gifts that of the Spirit, and they gave evidence to the fact that these were now filled with the Holy Spirit. So Jesus, again, during the time he was on earth, after his death, burial, and resurrection, and before he ascended back to heaven, said, I'm here to breathe on you disciples and let you receive the Holy Spirit. Now go and wait in Jerusalem for the day of Pentecost, when the rest of the power of baptism will come upon you and you'll be my witnesses. And by the way, there were 3,000 people meeting with Jesus But there were at least 120 later waiting for that baptism, and then the Holy Spirit came and filled the rest, not just the 12, but everyone else in that 120 meeting room. They were received the Holy Spirit and filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, all in very short order or arguably at the same time. But then they went out spreading that good news of salvation beyond that. And the natural course was under its way. So both were spoken of by Jesus, and now in Acts chapter 19, we see both of them happening. We see salvation and receiving the Holy Spirit, and we receive them with the Holy Spirit coming upon them. So after this, we've got two more passages of Scripture to look up. And first of all is Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. Probably going to have to read it on the board. Here we go. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Actually, Jesus starts speaking in verse 7. He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has done what? Come upon you." He didn't say you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes and dwells in you. He doesn't say that you'll receive power when you get saved. No, is God powerful? Can he do everything? Sure, I'm not going to say those things cannot happen. I'm sure that God will use us in our broken, screwed up doctrine state in no matter what, just to say, "God, I'm yours," and he uses us in our brokenness many times. But he makes a clear distinction. He says, "You shall receive power. I've already breathed on you." And this again, the same night. This is the same night when he met with his disciples and breathed on them and told them to receive the Holy Spirit. He says, "But now you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the other parts of the earth." The other passage of Scripture we said, Jesus himself also said, "Stay in Jerusalem until you are baptized with the Holy Spirit." And so we see the word that when Jesus says you're going to be baptized with the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit came upon them, that both of those were the same event. That the Holy Spirit being baptizing someone, or being baptized in the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit coming upon them are similar events, especially when you think about that tongues of fire sitting upon each one of them. The what's and where's and how for's is basically like this again. I've used this illustration before. When I was flying as a kid to the Bahamas with my dad, he was a pilot, and he had a four-seater Cessna, and we took off from here at Titusville, Dunn Air Park, and we flew over to the Bahamas, and on Little San Salvador, which is an abandoned island then. Now it's one of the places that the cruise ships stop at Blue Half Moon Cay or something anyway now. But on that North Beach, yes, Joni's been there. On that North Beach, at low tide, our family landed on that beach on the hard sand there, and then pushed the airplane up out of the way, and we're able to stay in and camp out for the weekend. It was a really cool experience for a kid. But I remember as we were flying over there, we had, since because it was an international flight, FAA requirements were that we would take one of the flotation devices with us. And those approved flotation devices look just like the ones they did in airlines, and that is a yellow thing that sticks around your head and clips on. Has a little beacon light that goes off as soon as it hits the water automatically. When you pull the string, there's something called a CO2 cartridge inside it, and as soon as you pull that string, it punctures that cartridge, and immediately what was contained within that CO2 cartridge has now filled that entire vest. The pneuma, the air of that container, has now filled the rest of the container. And so it is when the Holy Spirit comes and lives in you, you receive your CO2 cartridge, if you will. You receive the Holy Spirit within your life, sealed in your heart under the day of redemption. But if we pull the string, if we do something intentional, the Bible says that if you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will he give the Holy Spirit to them that ask? To them that ask. Wasn't that the same as being saved? No. What he's talking about there is you've already received the Holy Spirit, but if you ask, he will fill you with his Holy Spirit. It is a separate act from salvation. It is a subsequent act from salvation, meaning it happens sometime after, maybe very close together, but sometime after I put on the vest, and if we crash in the water and survive, Then at some point, having put on that vest and receiving that CO2 cartridge, I'm pulling the string and now it's going to fill the container completely. And so the Holy Spirit, if you ask Him, will fill you with His Holy Spirit. And then you, the vessel, you, the temple of the Holy Spirit in whom God dwells, begins to fill all the rooms of your life. And the rooms of anger and selfishness have now, the windows have been opened and a new breeze is flowing through, and now it's called the Holy Spirit. Rooms of selfishness and self-serving and anger and lust, rooms of your hearts begin to open up, and the Holy Spirit fills the entire house of your temple. And then that temple, from the beginning to end, is like Solomon's temple, so full of the smoke of the Holy Spirit that the priests, in their praising and worship, could not contain themselves because of the amount of filling that the smoke of the Holy Spirit did in that temple. So the Lord fills us to overflowing. And the evidence or fruit of the Spirit is love instead of hate, joy instead of misery, peace instead of worry, long-suffering instead of impatience, gentleness instead of meanness, goodness instead of badness, self-control instead of a lack of self-control, faith instead of doubt. And so that fruit or evidence of the Spirit in you begins to fill all the parts of your house, including your mouth, when you're speaking to people who are very difficult. With your hands, when you begin to do things and serve in the power of the Holy Spirit, and as the Lord gifts you with His Holy Spirit, and He gives you certain gifts that we'll read about later, then as you minister those gifts, then He will empower you at all points. Now what happens is at some point we begin to say, hey, I want to do what I want. Shut the windows. Or open the windows, let the Holy Spirit out, or something. And the Holy Spirit, like a genie going back in the bottle, I guess, is still in you, sealed until the day of repentance, until the day of redemption. He's still sealed in your heart. You haven't lost your salvation. The Holy Spirit is still dwelling in you, but He no longer fills your temple. He is in your temple, but He does not fill your temple. And so the requirement of us who have been filled with the Holy Spirit or baptized with the Holy Spirit so that the ship is filled with water, those of us who have been baptized with the Holy Spirit because we've asked Him to so fill us with overflowing that every part of us is filled, when the water drains out, when the Spirit drains out, if you will, whenever Him filling us is no longer there because of sin in our lives, and we begin to choose what goes on in each room, and the stink of our stink decisions begin to stink up the house, then the fruit of the flesh is manifest. Hatred, envying, strife, division, self-serving, all the stuff that human beings are by nature. And so we say, wow, sure was nice being Spirit-filled for a while. And so there are whole denominations of people, and I'm not picking on anyone, but my understanding is that you want your Spirit-filled. That's it. You're a Spirit-filled believer from then on. My understanding, and this is Steve Goodner, my understanding of the Scriptures, are that you can be baptized / filled with the Holy Spirit and then not be filled with the Spirit because of sin. That's why Paul commands us. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's why Peter said, these are not drunk with wine as you suppose, but they are filled with the Holy Spirit. And Paul commands us, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Why does he command us to do that? Because there's times when we're not. He says there's times when you're in the Spirit and there's times when you're in the flesh. There's the fruit of the Spirit and there's the fruit of the flesh. And so every time we sin, we kind of deflate, if you will, and we need to be filled again. The problem is most people don't notice. They've been to a meeting, they cried at an altar, they were filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit began to manifest Himself through their lives. They're walking around loving everybody, joy, peace, long-suffering, all the fruit of the Spirit operating in their lives. Maybe perhaps even beginning to understand and manifest some of the gifts that the Holy Spirit gives, and everything's going good until they run into something that deflates them, drains their spirit, and they don't ask to be filled again, and then they're walking around in the flesh. But you see, the deception is that, oh no, you're a Spirit-filled believer. Don't you belong to XYZ denomination? Didn't you speak in tongues one time? Didn't don't you believe in being Spirit-filled? Weren't you filled with the Spirit? Weren't you? Well, then you're a Spirit-filled believer. All you got to do is try harder. And every time we try harder, we find what a failure that is. We long for the days and the first parts of our understanding of Christ when we were filled with the Holy Spirit and there was something different in our lives. Some people press in enough to be able to kind of like, you know, with their hands tied, still get up close enough to God and say, God, you know, I'm not sure how I'm doing this right. I'm going to yield myself to you. Okay, let's call it yield. Yield yourself to God. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's fine. The Scripture says, ask. How much more do you give the Holy Spirit to those that ask? But ask, yield, I don't care what word you use, but the idea of knowledge is knowing that though the Holy Spirit is contained in our hearts, we are not always filled with the Holy Spirit, and we need to be filled with the Spirit on a regular basis. That's why Paul said, I die daily. Because every day the old flesh comes in, deflates me, and I'm angry, the old Paul's coming out in me, and he says, that old flesh nature's got to die. That old flesh nature's got to die. And so he says, I die daily. I crucify the flesh daily so that the Spirit man might be filled again with His Holy Spirit as I yield to Him or ask Him to fill me. I don't care which term you want to use, whichever one you're most comfortable with. But one thing's for sure, it's got to be an act of our will and understanding to say, I'm pressing into You again, God. And I'm not just looking to pray more or get away from the crowd more or hide in my prayer closet. I'm here for a reason. And the reason is I am empty and I need to be filled again. Your Spirit still dwells in me, but I need Your Spirit to fill my spirit again until You return. I'm a spirit being stuck in a fleshly body that sins a lot with a stupid will that always does what it wants to, which is usually what the flesh wants and not the Spirit. I need You to fill me with Your Spirit. And so the very last verse we want to look at, just to finish it up, is also in Acts chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. It says, and suddenly there was a sound from heaven as a mighty rushing wind, and it filled, everybody say filled, the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them divided tongues of fire and sat where? Upon each of them. So there's two different terms, filled, upon. Look at the next verse. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, verse 4. So the Holy Spirit coming was that which is called fire, upon, filled, baptized with. Those are all interchangeable terms. And as we finish today's teaching, my challenge to you as a pastor is that you don't get hung up on the vocabulary. You may have come from a background that every year taught against the power and fullness of the Holy Spirit. Might have been taught that them people were speaking in tongues as of the devil, or Pentecostals are heretics. And then if you maybe you came in a Pentecostal background and you were just sure that them Baptists didn't even believe in the Holy Spirit yet, let alone have Him, could be filled or anything. I was filled the first time with the Holy Spirit when I was Baptist. I was very anti-Pentecostal. But a pastor came to church by the name of Jack Hiles, and if you're an independent Baptist very long, you know that name is like super Mr. I'm independent Baptist, anti-Pentecostal. Came to the Bible College, to the Sunday morning service, actually, or Sunday night service, in Jacksonville, Florida, where I was back in the day. And he preached a message about fresh oil. As quoting David, where David said, I shall be anointed with fresh oil. That oil representing the Holy Spirit. And he challenged us preacher boys and everyone else in that service. Say, if you're going out on Thursday night visitation and trying to win souls for Christ, which we were regularly every Wednesday, and you don't have the power of the Holy Spirit, you are spinning your wheels. Because you are powerless. Oh, God's going to save some folks here and there, and the Word of God's still going to accomplish its work, but you are powerless because you are not filled with the Holy Spirit. You have not been anointed with fresh oil. And he says, I'm not talking about them Pentecostals. Well, he was, but he, you know, tried to make a distinction because of a hang-up about tongues or something. But he encouraged us to come to the altars and ask the Holy Spirit to fill us. And I went to the altar that night, and I believed what I heard. I said, Lord, I want to be anointed with fresh oil. I want to be filled with your Holy Spirit. I already know you're in me. I want you to fill me. And I want you to do with me whatever you want. And when I go out on visitation, I want to have power like it talked about there in the New Testament. You shall be my witnesses, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth after this Holy Spirit has come upon you and you're baptized. And so I prayed that day, and you know what happened? I got up and no, I didn't speak of tongues. I didn't believe in it. I don't believe in those things. You don't do what you don't believe in. But I did believe in being filled with the Spirit. And do you know what happened the next Thursday? I went out on soul-winning visitation and led a couple of people to the Lord. A couple of people. Two different people or more to the Lord that first time. And you know what happened the next time I went out? I led somebody else to the Lord. And the next week, and the next week. And by the time I was done, there were, I don't remember how many, dozens of people I'd led to the Lord in the rest of my time there at Trinity. Because somebody believed in the power of the Holy Spirit enough to teach me that having the Holy Spirit in me was not enough, but that I needed power of the Holy Spirit. There were gifts, there was fruit to be had in my life, there were all kinds of things the Holy Spirit wanted to work in my life, and I yielded myself to Him at that time. Now, there are Pentecostals that would say, you couldn't have been filled with the Holy Spirit, you didn't speak with other tongues. There could be Baptists that would say, you weren't filled with the Holy Spirit, that's Pentecostal. You know what? I don't want to listen to either one. All I can tell you is my experience. And then my study of the Scriptures and what I believe the Word of God has taught me. And that's what I'm sharing with you. So I either made you very uncomfortable. I talked to a guest this morning and I'm like, dude, it's either going to be a great Sunday for you or it's going to be a great day to leave. But today you've been given the Word. And we'll learn more about the gifts of the Spirit at another time, the ones that he talks all about in the next couple of chapters. But I don't want to leave today without two things happening, giving two opportunities. One is that if you've never been saved, that you receive the Holy Spirit into your heart, who will regenerate you, who will baptize you into the body of Christ and make you a new believer. And if you've been a believer for a while, you've been baptized into the body a while back, but you've never let the Holy Spirit fill you, at least not intentionally. There were times where you did well. Clearly, the fruit of the Spirit was happening in your life. You may have even had some kind of gifts in operation in your life, but you've never consistently walked in the Spirit as Paul commands. You've consistently been in the flesh, but you would like to begin a lifestyle that says, I want to discipline myself to regularly ask the Holy Spirit to fill me with His Spirit so that I can regularly walk in the Spirit with the fruit of the Spirit being exemplified in my life, with the gifts of the Spirit being used through me when He sees fit. So if you would bow your head and close your eyes just for a moment, and if you're here today and you say, I've never done that first thing, I'm kind of like those disciples of John, I'm kind of following this religion thing, but I'm not really sure that I've really connected, I'm not sure I've really gone through the door. I'm not sure I've really ever been saved. Not sure I'm going to heaven today if I died. But I'd like to make sure. Done everything I know to this point, even sitting in a church, but I need God to regenerate me from the inside out. I need to quit trying by my own abilities. I need the Holy Spirit to change me from the inside out and make me a new man. Many of you have prayed this prayer right in this room before. But if you've never prayed that prayer, I invite you to pray this prayer with us as we pray it out loud together. Dear God, I pray that you would come into my heart and save me. Make me a new creation. Make a place in heaven for me. Thank you for coming into my heart and saving me from hell and from my own self. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed that prayer for the first time today and meant it, welcome to the kingdom of God. Welcome to the body. You're a believer now. You need to be baptized in water as the first evidence of what God's done in your heart. Now, for the rest of us, I have one more prayer. It's 5 minutes after 12. One more prayer. You got time? Let's take 30 seconds or a minute and pray another prayer, shall we? 2 minutes? All right. I'm going to pray a prayer from my heart. I've been saved before, but I'm just going to ask God that He continue the work that I talked about this morning. And if you want to pray, you just pray along. You can pray silently this time. I don't want everybody to have to catch every word, but But you know that when you're praying along in agreement with somebody, you can pray that in your heart as well. Dear God, I thank you for teaching us from your word the importance of being born again and the need and opportunity for the Holy Spirit to come into our lives and make us new creations, believers and followers of Jesus Christ, residents of heaven, born again, children of God, on our way to heaven, having been saved from hell. We thank you, Lord, that you have done that in my life. And Lord, I thank you also for showing me on that fateful day, Lord, a time where I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit because I was powerless. I was powerless to be good. I was powerless to be pure. I was powerless to be able to witness with power and effectiveness to other people. And Lord, I need and recognize that I need the power of the Holy Spirit working in my life. Lord, you promised that we would receive power when the Holy Spirit had come upon us. And so, Lord, I pray that you would empower me by letting your Holy Spirit come upon me now. Lord, I believe you're already in my heart. All I'm asking you to do is fill me, as the Scripture teaches, that we would be Spirit-filled, filled with the Holy Spirit. Lord, where I have sinned and become selfish, Lord, in the rooms of my life, God, I confess that as sin, thanking you, Lord, you have already forgiven me. But Lord, as a forgiven, empty vessel, I just pray that you would fill me with your Spirit. And where there was selfishness, Lord, there would be others-mindedness, Lord. And where there was hatred, that there would be love. And where there was depression, there would be joy. And where there was worry, there would be peace. And where there was impatience, let there be long-suffering. Goodness, gentleness, meekness. Father, the fruit of the Spirit, may it come forth in my life. And help me, Lord, to remember after I maybe sin later in the day or impatient with somebody. Lord, help me to quickly confess that as sin and to ask again to be filled with the Spirit so that I can start a walk with being in the Spirit, not just a one-time event, not just a single baptism, but a continual filling. A continual walk in the Spirit, which will not always be consistent, will not always be perfect, but can be. And I pray, Lord, that you'd help me to strive for that kind of walk with you, Lord, that would help me to regularly be filled with the Spirit so that I might have power to witness, so that the fruit of the Spirit might be manifested in my life, and so that the gifts of the Spirit, Lord, would also be free to operate in myself and in my church. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. More on that later. Stand if you will. I want to pray that blessing over you, or speak that blessing that God told Moses to speak over his people. I always start on that side. I'm going to start over here. May the Lord bless you. Woo! Power. Just kidding. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May make his face to shine upon you. Even you, Pete, that's looking around the other way. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. For you are blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear, Kim? For who is like the Lord? Go in his peace today and be filled. Amen.